and welcome to the Word of Truth, the Sunday School class of the air with your teacher, Rod Payne. The Word of Truth.
Hello and welcome once again to the Word of Truth. I'm glad that you've chosen to spend the next roughly half hour with me and the crew as we continue our study in the book of Jeremiah. Today we'll be in Jeremiah chapter 7. It is a very, very strong word from the Lord, and it really has a lot of application for today. So I'm glad you're here, and I hope that you've already had the opportunity to look at today's lesson in your quarterly. If you have not, or if you do not have one of those, I would love to be able to provide one for you, absolutely free of charge. We would like to be able to provide one. The team here would like to be able to provide a quarterly for you, absolutely free of charge. It may be a little too late to get in on this quarter, but you can always write to us in that same time that you write to us asking if you don't have one for a quarterly. You might also share with us a prayer request that we can pray for you or for someone for whom you care or about a situation. The address that you can write to is The Word of Truth, 1200 9th Street, Wichita Falls, Texas, and our zip code is 76301. That address again is The Word of Truth, 1200 9th Street, Wichita Falls, Texas, and our zip code is 76301. Here we are, somewhere around Father's Day, depending on when you're watching this program, and a very, very happy Father's Day to all of you folks who are dads, okay? And I trust that everyone has a dad, because we all had to have had a dad at some point, and I also trust that you have and know your Heavenly Father. So I just hope that this is a great weekend or a great time around this part of June for you guys who are dads. I certainly love and revere mine, and I appreciate very much all of the dads I know. There's one dad in particular that I call in addition to my own father, I call one father that I have known for over 35 years, and I have not missed a Father's Day since he and his wonderful wife left Wichita Falls years ago. But I always call Daryl Cagle on Father's Day every year. And he knows he can count on that call. And he is a guy that I really esteem and really, really admire very, very much. I admire a lot of guys. And I'm sorry I don't call every one of you, but I have called Daryl because I just miss him greatly. And he has been a big, big influence in my life for, like I say, more than 35 years. Well, I don't have to tell you what's been going on in the world. And I don't have to tell you what's been going on in the weather. And all the things that have been happening and the great need that there is for prayer. In addition, there is a tremendous need for prayer because people today, so many of them, seem bent on having a form of godliness, but as the word says, lacking the power thereof. Jeremiah today, under the inspiration of God, and saying that in fact this word came, or these words came from God himself, Jeremiah is going to be speaking to the people then, but I believe he's speaking to us today, and he's speaking to the world at large today when he talks about the false way that they exercise their faith, and that in fact, they're really not exercising faith at all. I like to work out. And on occasion, I drink milk with protein powder in it, and I have for many, many years. And I've tried a variety of different ones, but I've always tried to also make sure that I look at the ingredients, and obviously, I do want it to taste somewhat decent. And I also take vitamins, a daily vitamin, as well as some other things that I think enhance my immune system and things of this nature. But I've always tried to make sure that I test and try, just like the word says about spirits, test and try every spirit. I try to make sure that I test and try those things that I put into my body. Now, I have to confess, I do not always eat right. In fact, I don't eat right a lot. But I do try to take the supplementation that I feel enhances my quality of life and helps me to feel better and helps my workouts. And at my age, I do like to work out vigorously about 6 days a week. Sometimes I have to miss, like back in April of this year when I was working with the tornado relief up in Oklahoma. I couldn't always have my workouts, couldn't have my workouts at all when I was up there. But by and large, I like to work out. But when I take a supplement, I want to make sure that what it says it is, and that what it says it can help with, it can truly help with. There's a lot of things out there that people make claims for, but they're not always true claims. And just because someone says something does not make it the case. In the lesson that we're going to look at today, God is going to be talking to his people. And I believe, again, down through the ages to me, he may not be speaking to you, but I know as I was preparing our time together today and I was reading this word and reading the quarterly and commentary material, I know he was speaking to me about my own life. And you may find, if you've already read the lesson, you may have already found that as you read it. But if you haven't, as we spend this time together, you and I, you may find that this lesson speaks to you in some way as well. Jeremiah, the 7th chapter, we'll begin with verse 1. Now, we've already talked about the early part of Jeremiah in the first 2 weeks of our time together in this new study. And now he continues the word from the Lord for the people that really need to hear it. And I believe you and I need to hear it. The world we live in today in the year 2023 needs to hear it as well. Verse 1, this is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. It didn't come from his own head or his own thoughts or heart. It came from God. Verse 2, stand at the gate of the Lord's house and there proclaim this message. Now, your quarterly correctly points out, as do other Bible commentaries and other Bible illustrative materials, that since this was a very northern city in the southern kingdom, Jerusalem is very northern, that most people probably enter the temple from the south. So he is probably standing in the southern entrance of the temple, and he is addressing everyone within earshot. Now remember, there wasn't a whole lot to occupy their time in that day and age. They didn't have the world at their fingertips on their cellular phones or on their computers or on their television sets or their radios in their cars. They didn't have any of these things. So when a man stood at the entrance to the temple of God and he began to proclaim what God had laid on his heart, yes, trust me when I tell you, we know there were folks who were listening. Verse 3, hear the word of the Lord, all you people of Judah who come through these gates to worship the Lord. I'm sorry, that's the back half of verse 2. All you people who come through these gates to worship the Lord. Now, ostensibly they say they're coming through the gate so that they can worship God. But in all sincerity, what they're really doing is just trying to fulfill what they believe to be a religious ritual, if you will, or an obligation. They don't really have a personal relationship with God, nor do they really desire to hear his will for them or their lives or their nation. Now, surely, and in fact, I'm fairly certain that we know this historically, surely they know what's already taken place in the northern kingdom. But here they are under the impression, mistaken as it is, that somehow or another they're going to escape God's judgment and get away scot-free, even though they continue to break his rules, his laws, his principles, ignoring his precepts. They're under the mistaken impression that somehow or another they're just going to be able to get a get-out-of-jail-free card. Again, looking at the year in which we're living today, the year 2023, and looking at the world where we find ourselves. We find ourselves in a world that says, just as it was, says the Word of God, says in the days of Noah, people were going about their business, and all of a sudden here comes this flood, and it eradicates all life on earth, save those that were saved by God within God's provision, the ark. Jeremiah is led to say by God as he stands in that gate, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Reform your ways and your actions, and I'll let you live in this place. Now, that's the NIV translation. Some other translations might say, I'll let you continue to live in this place. God had promised them before their exodus from the horrific, way that they were enslaved in Egypt. God had promised them, and actually before that time, he had said to Abram, I'm taking you to a land you don't know. I'm going to give you, God had told them, I'm going to give you this land. If you remember the story, they sent over 12 spies. 10 of them came back and said, they're overwhelming. The odds we face are overwhelming. There's no possible way we can beat this, so we're not going to want to go. And two of them came back and said, let's trust God. He said it. I believe it. Let's do it. Here's what God says now. I'll let you live in this place. Verse 4, do not trust in deceptive words and say, this is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. Body of Christ, if we're not careful, we're guilty of doing the same thing. And I'm not pointing the finger at anybody. I'm going to point them all back at me. Because I'm guilty of saying, I'm saved by His grace. And I'm sanctified through the Holy Spirit. And I have that grace greater than all my sin. But that does not give me license to do so. It does not give me freedom to sin. It gives me forgiveness when I stumble, as all will. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's what the Word says. There was only one sinless person, Jesus Christ. But it doesn't give me the license to sin, and it certainly shouldn't encourage me to sin to say, well, but I've got this get out of jail free card. I've got this pass. I've got already the blood of Christ covering my sin, so I can, if I'm not careful, I'm vain in my repetition of just reciting and repeating things that I've heard and that I know, as opposed to living them out in my life, believing them, and having the faith to move in them. Okay? Living them out in my life, believing them, and having the faith to move in them. I know His Word. I don't know it as well nearly as any biblical scholar, and certainly more than likely not as well as most of you watching this program. But I do know the Word, and I read it, and I read through it. But even then, for me just to say the words and not mean it, it's kind of like what I talked about at the beginning of the program. When you'll see something in an ad, in a magazine perhaps, or in a program or something like that, and they say, well, if you take this particular item, it's going to revitalize, or it's going to restore your vitality, or it's going to whatever. Now, some things are scientifically proven to be beneficial to us, and we know these things are. And they've been tested in labs that had no vested interest in the product itself. They just wanted to ensure that product's accuracy, or the claims made by the product, the accuracy of those claims. But in this case, Jeremiah is saying, people are just standing there saying, this is the temple of the Lord, this is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. As if by repeating that, repeating what is a known fact, by the way, it is truly the temple of the Lord. But we're recording this program in the worship center at First Baptist Church. This is the place where the church gathers, but this is not the church. The church are the people who gather here. The church are those people who suffer for their faith in many third world and Islamic particularly countries. The church is the body of believers who go out into their community and minister to those in need. The church are those who lift one another up in prayer, beseeching the throne on another's behalf and comforting them in their sorrow and being alongside them as they walk together in faith. That's the church. And so just to say, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, that really has no bearing if our lives do not bear it out. Did you hear me? It really has no bearing if our lives don't bear it out. He says, verse 5, if you really change your ways and your actions and deal with each other justly, if we change our ways, but more than just what we say, but he says then in the NIV translation, and depending on what translation you're reading, it's probably very similar, change your actions, and then deal justly with one another. There were those in this day, as there are in this day, who by virtue of their position could lord it over others and could have their way in others' lives. Now here we are today with, in this day and time, and I'm not going to go political on you, but it's frightening. And there are stronger words, but I think frightening is an appropriate word. It is frightening to see what those who are in leadership, who have been placed in positions of leadership in government, it is frightening to see and to hear the personal ideologies that they espouse or the personal worldviews that they profess. To hear someone say that people from one gender dressed up as the other gender and flaunting their, I guess, strange ways. I don't know. There are probably more polite ways to put that, and I hope that doesn't sound impolite, but flaunting that they should be allowed to address school children and confuse them, because obviously those folks are confused, and why not be able to take that lifestyle into our schools and confuse them as well? There are those in the highest positions of government affairs and of government in our nation that believe abortion should be legal and be available on demand. How can you reconcile that with God's word or with a faith? I don't know. And yet from one side of their mouth, collectively, they espouse a quote-unquote woman's right to choose, and from the other side of their mouth they say, I have a personal faith and it informs my life. Now, I can't sit in judgment. I can't. I'm not the judge. And I'm certainly no prophet in the fashion remotely of a Jeremiah. But when we read this word and we look at, again, the day and age in which we find ourselves, it'd be impossible not to make the comparison. It'd be a bigger stretch not to make the comparison than to make the comparison. In fact, it's no real stretch at all to make the comparison with what he's saying in that day and time. But he goes on to say, if you do not oppress the alien, the fatherless, or the widow, and do not shed innocent blood in this place, and if you don't follow other gods to your own harm, verse 7, then I will let you live in this place, in the land I gave your forefathers forever and ever. God had promised them. God had delivered it into their hand. And then they had left God. They had abandoned him for the other practices, for the evil practices of the false gods that had been in the land prior to their taking it. Now, body of Christ, he had freed them from captivity in Egypt, and he had delivered into their hand, I'll grant you, after 40 years of wandering. But after those 40 years, he had delivered into their hand an amazing gift, a land that was theirs to defend themselves in, to prosper in, and to see him and to experience his blessings in. And they had still said, let me turn to other gods. And here we are in the United States of America, and it's blessed beyond measure. Of all the nations in the world, you won't find one more blessed than the USA, the United States of America. From the way that our government was enacted and put together, to the Bill of Rights that we have, to the various ways that our government can function and serve people when it desires to, when it gets out of its mindset of you're going to have to change so you can fit my ideology. But when government is really there to serve the people, as was it was originally constructed and as was its original design, you won't find a more blessed nation. And you won't find a nation that's willing to do more for others than this country. Now, I'm not going to get political again, but let's talk about when he says those who are aliens. The alien in that day and time would have been someone who was not of Israeli descent. In our day and time, it's difficult to discern who is the alien. We often hear the term illegal aliens, those who are crossing our border, predominantly from the southern part, who have no desire to actually follow the law or apply for citizenship in the same way that anyone immigrating to this country would do so, but rather they're just hoping to be able to traverse the border, blend in whatever area that they eventually find themselves, and just begin their lives here. This is the land where they want to be. This is the land where they desire to be. And no matter where you stand on this, and I grant you, most folks, certainly in Texas, stand on the desire to at least have some way of discerning who's coming in and what are they bringing. Okay, I'm not being racist here, and I'm not being isolationist. I'm just saying a rational mind says we need to know who's coming in. body of Christ. I can't go, as has often been the case over these last 15 years or so, I can't go to Romania without having a passport and a proper entry visa, I believe, for the nation of Romania. Same way in England, same way with Hungary and in other nations. You know, I can't go to places. We know back at the first of the month, we celebrated Pastor Bob's 15 years of being here, and he has brought me to Romania and taken me with him to Romania numerous times. I can't go into that nation without some form of valid ID and passport. So I don't think it's too much to ask, for instance, that people be able to substantiate who they are before they participate in the electoral process of this country. I don't think that's too much to ask. But he says, regardless of all that, we need to be able to treat, we need to treat the alien, the fatherless. Let's go back again to that abortion question. Because so often, the children that are, their lives are lost in the process of abortion, more often than not, I would wager, are children who are not from a two-parent committed to one another in a marriage relationship. They are not the result of that. More often than not, they are the result of the act of a man and a woman coming together without that marriage bond between them. And then the woman says, I do not want to bear a child. We are to protect. We are to help. There are numerous scriptures that say this. We are to help the fatherless. We are to help the widow. We are to help the alien. And we're not to shed innocent blood. If you do not follow other gods to your own harm, then I'll let you live in this place in the land I gave your forefathers forever and ever. But look, you are trusting in deceptive words that are worthless. And we trust in a lot of deceptive words as people. We are all sheep, the word of God says, and we're led astray. We trust in a lot of deceptive words that are literally worthless. Okay? Everybody who invested their money with a guy who went to prison because he was hoodwinking, apparently, according to the indictments, he was taking a lot of people's funds and not delivering on the investment that they had made. Everyone who believed his empty promises, they believed deceptive words. But everyone who believes as well that somehow or another they are in charge, none of us are in charge. God is in charge. If you're familiar with the 12 steps, which I often use as an illustration here, you'll know that the first three steps basically say, we're not in charge. God is in charge. We better let him be. There are still a lot of people who are trusting the deceptive word that they are telling themselves, which say, I am the center of the universe. I am the center of all the world, and everything revolves around and must bow to my will. And that's not the case. Will you steal and murder, commit adultery and perjury, burn incense to Baal, and follow other gods you've not known, and then come and stand before me in this house, which bears my name, and then say I'm safe? He asks not a rhetorical question. He's asking a real legitimate question. And again, down through the ages, we might want to say the same thing. Because the same politician that'll be carrying on with affairs and carrying on with stealing from their own constituents will then say, yeah, but every Christmas and Easter, I make sure to find my way into the house of God. Not just politicians, the normal, as we say, rank and file, the folks who are just living their lives. Used to be that you could catch country and western television programs generally on Saturday afternoons, early evenings, on a lot of local and other TV stations. And these were what they call syndicated programs. They were recorded, and then they were sent out on videotape or on film to various stations. And it was the practice of most of them to play all kinds of songs about infidelity and getting out, getting drunk and being in bars and meeting strange other people and stuff of that nature. But then right before the close of the program, it was generally something, a set piece would drop down, something that looked like a stained glass window or perhaps a cross or something. Now I'd like to sing a song to the Lord. And some song would be intoned, and then it would fly back up into the top of the roof, and off we go to one last song about tears in your beer. Body of Christ, it can't be both ways. It can't be in my life. This is a very convicting word for me. And the times that I'll just say, well, I'm going to get by, as opposed to staying in the faith and staying true to Him. I cannot worship Baal. In other words, I cannot worship the monetary system or the popular thing or the thing that the vast majority says. What if Noah had listened to the vast majority? Okay, just give yourself some thought there. They say, we're safe, safe to do all these detestable things. Has this house, which bears my name, become a den of robbers to you? But I've been watching, declares the Lord. Go now to the place in Shiloh where I first made a dwelling for my name and see what I did to it because of the wickedness of my people. You remember Shiloh? And you remember who served there? The chief priest and his two sons. And he let his two sons get away with murder. And it did not work well. And when he hears of their deaths, he falls over and he dies. Okay. I spoke to you again and again, but you didn't listen. I called you, but you didn't answer. Therefore, what I did in Shiloh, and they were destroyed there. They were defeated there. I will now do to the house that bears my name, the temple you trust in this place I gave to you, your fathers. I will thrust you from my presence. And the word thrust there means literally I will hurl you. Or like a lion, I'll grab you and I'll throw you down on the ground. But the word translated in the NIV is, I will thrust you from my presence just as I did your brothers to the people of Ephraim. I'm going to get rid of you. I am going to do away with you. And body of Christ, I don't want that. And I don't believe you want that for this nation. The prayer has got to be, we have got to pray for revival. And it starts in me. It starts in us, and then it can sweep through the nation, and it can reclaim this nation to not be a people of just lip service, but a people who live, who believe, and act on their faith. Well, as always, I want to thank you for watching. Remember, you can always write to us at The Word of Truth, 1200 9th Street, Wichita Falls, Texas. Our zip code is 76301. That address again is The Word of Truth, 1200 9th Street, Wichita Falls, Texas, and our zip code is 76301. Please write to that address and let us know how we may pray for you. We'd be honored to pray for you. Let us know how we can pray for someone else for whom you care, or a situation or a circumstance. Just let us know that you're watching the program. If you got a criticism or a critique, we'd like to hear that as well. But please write to us at that address that you see on your screen. We're going to continue our study in the book of Jeremiah, jumping a few chapters, I'll grant you, next week. So I hope you'll be with us here on The Word of Truth as we continue this rich, powerful, and yes, convicting study here in the book of Jeremiah. That's next week here on The Word of Truth.
You've been watching The Word of Truth from First Baptist Church, Wichita Falls. Join us again next week for The Word of Truth.